Guess who we caught up with at a Jadi Cafe to talk about Muhammad Ali Kwabena Ejepon. Yes, he's in town. Kwabena is in town. Hi. Hello, sir.
Hi, Paul.
How are you doing?
I'm very fine.
I put these gloves here so that people will know that we are talking about boxing.
We're talking about boxing.
We know that you are a great sports presenter, sports journalist, football commentator. Well, I never heard you comment on do boxing commentary because in those days, we get the feed from elsewhere and the commentary came with it. But occasionally, Edward Fati used to do something. Well, how was it at GBC those days?
I did the Azuma Nelson and Sidney Dalrovier.
Okay.
Yeah, when Azuma defended against the Brazilian here, I ran the commentary.
Oh, the one that Azuma fought in Ghana.
In Ghana.
Yes.
And also, when Nanayao
Kunedu
fought.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it was Cesar Polanco, I believe. Yes.
Yeah.
At the Accra Sports Stadium, and I ran the commentary as well. So.
How was the job in those days?
Well, I was a young man. It was very interesting. I loved sports, so it was great to be part of it. And it was nice to follow sports around the world. I can say that, in all humility, I'm one of the few Ghanaians who saw the 1984 Olympics in LA, 1988, Seoul Olympics, 1992 Barcelona, 1996.
Oh, you were presently there, all of these Olympic Games?
Yes, I watched it.
As an official commentator or as a spectator?
I used to host Sports Our Lights at the time. Mm-hmm. In those days, you're not sponsored to go and do it. In 84, I was on a private holiday, and that's how I saw it. Mm-hmm. So, but that's how my interest in sports presentation got ignited.
You know, so how did you used to get the news? If Ali had died in 84, how would you have heard it?
Well, in those days, we used to fall on BBC.
Radio?
BBC Radio, yes.
How did you tune it?
Well, we could tune BBC Focus on Africa. And I remember when I was in university at Tech, I was one of the few people who used to follow the English League, even in those days, and get the live commentary. And there were quite a number of people who used to complain to the hall tutor. And I'm disturbing.
I see.
One of them is Moses Asaga.
Oh, okay, that's interesting. that's an interesting.
Yes, yes.
Why did you open it too loud?
Very loud, and I'll make noise at night about it and practice the commentary when it's over, you know. And, you know, sports, I've been very passionate.
So if Ali died in 84, we wouldn't have known it the same day, would we?
Well, I don't think so. Maybe the next day. Maybe the next day, because in those days,
we can't believe that
every 3:30 people go and tune BBC just to listen to what is happening in Ghana.
Oh, in Ghana?
Yes, even in Ghana, because there was only one channel, Ghana Broadcasting. We were under a military dictatorship, and so therefore, information even about our own country, sometimes we had to rely on BBC Focus on Africa, and it was very different. I mean, I think our generation, we've been lucky. Because the last 15 years, the technological advancement that we've seen in television, in the digital age, it's amazing. Our fathers never saw HD television or even color television. And today you can just transmit something by WhatsApp, and it's so different. You know, and I think that we should be thankful to God that we've lived through. I don't know whether the world is going to advance a lot more technologically, but I think where we are now, perhaps we are reaching a saturation point.
Well, Mark Zuckerberg will tell you we've not gotten anywhere yet. Bill Gates says we haven't even scratched the surface.
President Obama, who said yesterday that we feel fortunate that we saw the greatest in our generation. Because I don't think there will be another Muhammad Ali. Ali transcends sport. He transcends boxing. He even the word the icon is been bandied about, legend and all that. He's bigger than that. It's not enough to describe him. You know, this is a young man who burst onto the world stage at 18 years, winning the Olympic heavyweight title in Rome, I believe, at 18.
Well, the famous Rome Olympics of 1960?
Yeah.
Oh, Ali wasn't it?
Ali was the heavyweight champion.
Okay. And this is when President Kennedy was still president in the United States.
Yes, he's young, brash guy. He started like a braggart, you know. He used to have exciting press conferences. He had a certain love-hate relationship with the media. You know, but today you see some of his quotes and you begin to wonder his level of intellect. This was an intelligent person, a very high IQ. You know, so the things that Ali said, it wasn't surprising that later on he joined the civil society movement, the civil rights movement.
What was your first sort of view of Muhammad Ali? For people of my generation, we never saw him. By the time we were born, he was retiring. But for some of us, when Mike Tyson fought, for some of us, when Sugar Ray Leonard fought, Michael Spinks, they said to us that he looked like Muhammad Ali.
No.
You know, we saw some tapes later.
I think Sugar Ray Leonard looked copied Ali's style. I believe Ali, when he didn't go for the draft, I mean, he was against the Vietnam War, he became very political, he changed his religion and all that. And then when he was stripped of his wealth, I mean, that was his peak.
Tell us about that story. What was that about?
You're stripped of his, you know, in those days, every citizen in America, you're supposed to serve in the army.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you, at the time that he was supposed to go and serve in the army, that was the Vietnam War, which he felt was not... He wasn't for it. He was not in favor of the war.
That it was a wrong decision.
It was a wrong decision to go to war. I mean, for a young African American at the time, considering the history of the struggle for civil emancipation in America, for to have the courage to stand up against the establishment at the time, it just brought out the man in him. You know, and so he became.
So he was a world champion when he said, "I won't go for war."
Yes, he was a world. He was a world champion. Mm-hmm. And then once he was stripped of the world title, that was after the famous Sonny Liston fight.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Sonny Liston was the one who was known as the Beast. He used to knock out people. There were rumors that he was even involved in some robberies and all that. He was a fearsome character.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there are videos of Ali calling him out, like, "I'm going to beat you," and Sonny Liston said, "Two rounds." Ali was laughing, and how he was able to float around the ring and box him and defeat him and win the fight. I mean, Ali was strong enough to say that if you should be a fool to bet on Sonny.
Mm.
And you see it on tape today. And he won. Shocked the world. And he said it. I've shocked the world. I must be the greatest. You know, and there's never been such finesse in sport and history. And he became, you know, a worldwide character. You know, so every country knew of Muhammad Ali, how great he was, and everybody loved him because he's got such a solid sense of humor, and he used to travel around the world, and he was a true world champion. In those days, we didn't have that many alphabet bodies, as we call them these days. There was only the World Boxing Council and the World Boxing Association, and it's predominantly...
Oh, I see, the WBC and the WBA.
And the WBA, because they used to sanction fighters from South Africa.
The IBF was not there?
No, the IBF came later.
Okay.
IBF came much later. It came out of the WBA.
Mm.
You know, so a lot of African countries and those who did not like apartheid, who don't want to deal with South Africa, never dealt with the WBA. So the WBC champions were the real champions of the world.
Mm.
But Ali unified everything. He was the heavyweight champion of the world at the time. And for him to lose his title, just fighting for civil rights and, you know.
So how did he get it back?
Later, I think he served a term of just over 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then Ali, Fraser had then become champion,
mm-hmm.
Joe Fraser. So, you know, they had a big battle in 1971, and that was the first time Ali was defeated. He was knocked down. In those days, boxing was 15 rounds.
Oh, it was still 15 rounds then?
Oh, yeah, 15 rounds for a considerable amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
And Ali retook his title in Kinshasa when he fought Foreman. And everybody at the time, because Foreman had knocked out Frazier 5 times in Kingston, Jamaica, you know, and Frazier had knocked Ali. At least he had put him down. He won on points, but he knocked him in the 15th round and won on points. And it was a major shock. Everybody thought that was the return of Muhammad Ali. Mm-hmm. Ali had another fight with Frazier and beat him on points,
mm-hmm.
you know. And then Foreman then was the world champion at the time. So that big fight in Africa, Mobutu Sese Seko, who wanted to make a...
We'll not talk about that politically, whether I was right or wrong, but do you think it's a sad part of Ali's history or is a minus to Ali's history that he succumbed to the delicacies of Mobutu Sese Seko and agreed to take his image, his global image, sent to Zaire, to the camp of this dictator? You know, who was pepped up by the Cold War and all of that. And Ali's fight and Ali's presence really endorsed Mobutu and the kinds of things that he was doing.
I don't quite think so. At the time, I don't think anybody talked about that. I mean, everybody was excited to see Muhammad Ali. Mm-hmm. And Foreman was looked at as this man with such brute force.
Foreman was a champion?
Was a champion.
George Foreman.
George Foreman. He had beaten, as I said, Joe Frazier knocked him down 5 times in Kingston, Jamaica, and the famous fight when he knocked him off the canvas, you know. And so
Frazier fell off the canvas.
I mean, he was lifted off. I mean, the video is there. His whole body was lifted off the canvas, one punch, you know. So it was a similar one to Ali's fight with Sonny Liston, and the whole world was waiting with bated breath to watch that fight.
To watch Ali and Foreman.
And it's a creation of Don King. Don King decided that let's go into the jungle. Well, I think that was not too complimentary of Africa to say, as if the world tried to look on us as if we were in a jungle, you know. So the rumble in the jungle and all sorts of things. But Ali was a world figure, and everybody loved to have him.
But why did they agree to fight in Mobutu's camp?
That was when boxing and sport was being commercialized, and I think that Mobutu was able to put up the money for the, and Don King was
he's a money man.
Yeah, apart from that, he was making a lot more money from promoting Ali fights and all that. That was the beginning of the commercialization of sport, and he took advantage of that also to go to another frontier. He did not believe that a world champion should always be fighting in America. Now there are other parts of the world, and Ali had that philosophy. Let me go to Africa. That's where my roots are. So I think that at the time, nobody really, yes, we all knew the history of Mobutu, but that really wasn't, I don't consider that a blockbuster.
So this fight was held in a stadium?
In a stadium.
In Kinshasa?
On the 30th of October.
And, you remember?
1970, because I was in Form 1, in infancy school at the time. Yes.
Ah, I see.
Yes, and I remember all of us huddled around, one of the seniors had a radio, and we listened to it. In those days, there was this popular African station, the Gabonese, used to be Africa Numero 1.
Yeah, we heard about it.
Yeah.
But it was a French station.
Yes, but we listened to it. That's why this...
In French?
Boumaye, Ali, Boumaye, and all that became a household word.
Okay, what did that mean?
Ali killed him, something like that.
Okay.
You know, so that's my recollection of it. As a young man, it was at night.
How did you feel the hype, the technology? And I always like to come back to
that. At that time...
You didn't have WhatsApp, you didn't have Facebook, online. How did the hype of Ali's fight in Zaire affect you, a young man, in a Fans Prem school in Cape Coast?
You could only take it from the newspapers.
The Ghanaian newspapers?
The Ghanaian, there were two, Ghanaian Times and Daily Graphic. You know, so, and those of us who love sports, I used to follow the library prefect. Because then I was the one who was asked to go to town to bring the newspapers because of my affection for sports.
Okay.
I was responsible for taking the newspapers from Cape Coast town to come and paste it for the students to read. So I had an exit to town all the time.
Ah, I see.
by that. But, I mean, the whole world, this thing gripped the whole world at the time. Although there was no internet and television.
But somehow by the newspapers.
But somehow newspapers... The GTV radio was mentioning him because Ali was an icon. He was, you know, and everybody wanted to see the fight. Whether and how everybody was expecting Foreman to crush Ali, you know. And then Ali used what he referred to as the rope-a-dope. You know, that was his tactic. He was lying on the ropes, relaxed, boxing him. And the famous fight, we all saw what happened. He wore him down and then finished him in the 8th round. And everybody...
Oh, it was a knockout.
Knockout.
He knocked out George Foreman.
He knocked out George Foreman. After the 7th round, Foreman launched such a powerful rally, hit Ali with powerful body blows, and I think he expended far too much energy. Mm. Foreman was big, so it was difficult to move around. And Ali, you know, used that to his advantage in the 8th round and then knocked him out. It didn't look to be a very powerful punch, but he was exhausted, and he took him around the ring and knocked him right in the center of the ring. The British referee then was Zach Clayton, and he was wearing this funny, those things that the referees used to wear. It was black, white stripe, and, you know, black and white stripe uniform for referees in those days. And we just got to see the pictures later on. In the
I was going to ask you, so you never saw the video then of that
No,
fight?
No. We saw it later in life.
Years later
in life, yeah.
So when he finished George Foreman, had he established himself then as a world champion, boxing legend?
That was a big shock. And then Ali was back, and of course, talking the way he used to talk. And then Frazier then threw a challenge to him that, look, I want us to seal this once and for all.
What is it? Because they had two fights already.
Frazier had won one, Ali had won the second one, and then now the third one was the thriller in Manila. And Ali took it. to Philippines, the other side of the world. Mm-hmm. Again, as part of his, he's a remarkable character. You know,
this was Don King behind it again?
Don King behind it again. And huge fight. I think it's the fight that people blame for perhaps Ali's condition because he took so much punishment.
From Joe Frazier?
From Joe Frazier. And Frazier also took so much punishment. You should watch that fight. And I think the fight was stopped at the end of the 14th round. Mm. And the Frazier's corner were prevailing on him not to get back. He wanted to come back, but you should see the fight. Two boxers at the peak of their career and giving everything. These were dedicated fighters and great fight. And I don't think there's ever been a heavyweight fight like the Shirley in Manila.
Mm-hmm. I remember that Ali said a few things.
Very many things. You
know. He said it's going to be a killer, it's going to be a thriller.
When I meet the gorilla in Manila.
Yes, when I get that gorilla in Manila.
Yeah. He was always teasing and calling out his opponents, you know.
Were there other boxers in the world fighting at the time that Ali fought in the heavyweight division? Were there featherweights? Were there lightweights, super lightweights?
There were even great heavyweights. I remember Ali...
During Ali's...
The first time Ali was knocked down was in London. Ali took his circus everywhere. The great British heavyweight, Henry Cooper. Mm-hmm. He decked Ali with a big, big left hook, you know, and everybody believes that Angelo Dundee, the famous trainer of Ali, bought some few seconds in the corner, you know, pretending that he had misplaced a towel or something like that, because Ali was dazed, and, you know, people think that he couldn't have come out of his corner anymore, but he was able to revive Ali, for Ali to come and knock Henry Cooper out.
To win the fight?
He knocked him out.
I see.
He knocked him out in London. Ali was a man of many parts. I quite remember he even went to Japan and fought the world. He was a wrestling champion, Antonio Inoki. Mm. Yeah.
In a boxing ring?
Well, it was a match, whether it was a boxing or a wrestling match, they declared it a draw. Mm. But whilst he was boxing, Inoki was trying to wrestle him. You know, he was using this kickboxing techniques. You know, but that shows you the man. You know, he was a showman. Apart from that, he had such intellect and made such an impact on the lives of many people. Mm. You know, and I think that his loss is a loss to everybody.
When he converted to Islam and made obeisance to Elijah Muhammad and the Nation of Islam. Did that also affect his supporters? Does you as young people feel that the in thing to do was to convert to Islam the way Ali had done?
At the time, I don't think so. Mm. I mean... of course, everybody knew he was Cassius Clay. So in those days, we were using the two names interchangeably. Mm-hmm. You know, to latter the latter years that everybody stuck to Muhammad Ali. But, you know, the history of the civil rights movement and all that. So, and he led some of the matches. Ali perhaps was the first sportsman to mobilize politically mm-hmm. and have an impact globally. Mm-hmm. And when Ali spoke, the world noticed it. And see, that's why I said he transcends the sport.
Did he have any impact of apartheid? Did he say anything about apartheid then in the 70s?
Of course. I mean,
was he a Democrat or a Republican? Do we know?
I'll think that he associated more with the Democrats. Of course, they were the ones who, most of the African Americans were in the Democratic Party, although he could not say that he was frontally one, but he was always the likes of Elijah Muhammad, Malcolm X, and Martin Luther King, you know, because they were fighting for equality in America, and those were difficult periods. And he was one who was prepared, as I said earlier on, to even relinquish or lose his title, just fighting for what he believed in.
When did he finally leave the boxing scene?
That was 1980. I believe the last fight was not with Larry Holmes, but that was the last major fight in 1980.
He defeated Holmes?
No, Holmes defeated Ali.
Knockout?
Yeah, I mean technical knockout. The Ali's corner decided to discontinue the fight. I believe it was in the 10th round or so.
Mm. Oh, only third round?
10th round.
10th round, and he was old? He was over 30?
I mean, at that time, Ali was old. He was slowing down. And I think later, he went to Canada and also lost one fight. And then that was it. But that was Ali way past his best. You know? I think the best fight was the 1975 struggle in Manila when everybody saw Ali at his best. Mm. So people remember him for the three Frazier fights, the two Sonny Liston fights. In fact, he gave Sonny Liston a rematch, and everybody thought he was mad because this guy...
You didn't talk about the Floyd Patterson one. How was that one?
No, Floyd was a different type of boxer. He was more like Ali. You know, he was a crafty, looked a lot more like Mayweather. Mm-hmm. So they were two similar styles, mm-hmm. you know, and he was not a feared puncher. So although he had grueling contests with Ali, because they were similar in the way they fought, you know, but the exciting ones were with Ken Norton, for instance, broke Ali's jaw. Mm-hmm. Although Ali won on points, Ken Norton broke Ali's jaw. You know, Ali came back, fought him again, won. You know, so it is, you know, he's had some, those days, boxers used to fight quite
frequently. Boxing was fierce.
It was fierce. I mean, now it's all about
money. Now it's PR people, and media.
Yeah, media, people fight once in a year. I cannot understand.
But oh, they didn't do that those days? They fought regularly? They
fought regularly. I mean, you could have four fights in a year. It was very normal. You know, and again,
it was brutal. I mean, if you look at that Ali Fraser one, they were killing each other.
Because now it's become more like an economic spectacle. They sell it, they market it, and it's all about the money, how much money they make. It's not about who is champion, you know. So people are using different routes. I'm WBO champion. I'm IBF champion. WBC, WBA. You know, they are not determined to say I'm the best in the world. In those days, a boxer wanted to be known as the best in the world.
And they couldn't dodge fights those days, so no, something like...
Because they will call you out. I mean,
Mayweather did not want to fight Manny Pacquiao for a long time, and he determined it.
I never understood why. I mean, they should have fought much, much earlier than they did.
Mm-hmm.
And it's all about building it and making a lot of money out of it, which for me is good to make money out of it. But sport is about striving for excellence.
Did Ali make money?
Well, the last time I read, his estate is worth $30 million.
Which is not bad.
Which is not bad. For Ali was one of the first people to be paid over $1 million in those days. You know, so I think the Fraser fight, if my memory serves me right, was around $12 million. And that was when we were shifting.
75.
75.
That's an awful lot of money.
You know, when you're dealing with Duncan, a lot of things happen. So, you know, but at least from what we are reading from his estate, he's still worth a lot. But clearly, I mean, if Mayweather is worth over $400 million, and I don't think
he... At least he's not broke. At least Ali was not broke.
No, he wasn't broke. Mm. I mean, I think he took too much punishment. In those days, the rules and regulations and the role of medicine in boxing was not as pronounced as now.
Mm.
They having doctors at the ringside to stop fights and advice, it wasn't like that. So I'm sure there are fights that...
And in those days, it was 15 rounds, very punishing schedule.
Punishing rounds.
When did they come to 12?
If my memory serves me right, in the early 80s. I do believe around 83, 84, thereabouts.
Azuma Nelson's guy who beat him.
The first fight was, I think it's 1982.
Yeah, when Azuma lost the title.
To Salvador.
The guy who died.
He died in a
That was 15 rounds.
That was 15 rounds.
But Wilfredo Gomez, I think it was 12.
12 rounds in
Puerto Azuma took him out in 11th.
In 1984.
That was in 84, yes.
That was in 1984.
So by 84, it was 12 rounds?
Yes. I mean, there were a lot more health concerns.
Mm-hmm.
The medical commission of the World Boxing Council was becoming a lot more pronounced in how they were looking at boxing, and that 15 rounds was too long. Because when people get tired, they are more exposed to taking very serious punishment.
Mm.
And so and I think people learned a lot from what happened in Manila.
Mm.
Everybody understood that those 15 rounds, in fact, it ended at the end of the 14th in Manila between Ali and Fraser, perhaps was the fight that boxers took punishment, the two boxers. Amazing punishment. Everybody was throwing blows. There was no attempt to dodge or hide or, you know, they were there to fight each other.
Fraser died a few years ago.
Yeah. Fraser died a few years ago, and that's why there's a belief that there was not a lot of medical protection for the boxers much earlier on, and may have contributed to Ali's demise. The fact that he'd been struggling with Parkinson's for the better part of the last two decades, you know. So now you can have the doctors around the ringside; they are taking decisions. The referees are more alert; they are looking at the eyes of the boxers and determining whether they are fit to continue. So they are doing everything to make sure that we don't expose them to danger.
Is it the end of an era for something?
Well, I think the era ended some time ago. I mean, the era of the true boxing champion. I think latter-day boxers or latter-day managers of boxing have destroyed the sport. I mean, right now, if you ask me who is the world heavyweight champion,
it's difficult to tell. They don't have an undisputed champion.
Which is sad. I mean, I remember as a kid.
There are some in England, there are some in North America.
I remember as a kid in 1981, I wrote a letter to the president of the World Boxing Council. There was an African magazine called Afrosport, which was edited by the famous South African writer Bobby Naidoo. And I wrote a letter to them to try and use their good offices to bring the World Boxing Council and the World Boxing Association together. I was not to know that it was going west. Now, later on, the IBF popped up, and then...
It's all gone now.
It's all gone. There's IBO, there's WBO, there's... It's a joke now. And I think that it has destroyed boxing. It's all become money. Use another channel. It's entertainment. You know, be attractive.
But it's not getting the global attention. The last fight was the Floyd Mayweather and Manny Pacquiao fight, which was not a heavyweight bout. Heavyweight division, what's happened to it? Because Mike Tyson also sustained it for a very long time.
Because, you see, it depends on the one who's...
Riddick Bowe, Evander Holyfield. That was another golden generation.
As well, because they were prepared to...
Foreman was part of them, anyway.
He came back after 48 years to win the world title.
He got beaten by Evander Holyfield.
Evander Holyfield, that was a wonderful fight.
Yeah, absolutely.
Foreman really fought, you know, for someone at that age, you know, to be able to fight Holyfield the way he did. And... that was a wonderful generation.
What happened?
People were not avoiding people.
Yeah.
They were fighting. Tyson was prepared to take on all comers. And then he was shocked by Buster Douglas, who was knocked out by Evander Holyfield. Holyfield was not a true heavyweight. He was a cruiserweight champion. And then he moved up. And, of course, he had his very famous tiffs with Bo Tyson and Riddick Bowe. And then Lennox Lewis came into the picture. So that was a good generation. But it still cannot compare to Ali, Frazier, Foreman, Ken Norton, that era, where you could point out and say, this man is the heavyweight champion of the world. And because the heavyweight is the heaviest division, if you are the champion of the world, you are
the ultimate champion,
the strongest man on earth. And people wanted to carry the accolade around with that. These days, you don't seem to feel that they want that. They just want to make some money. So you have Hayes sitting somewhere claiming he's a world champion in Britain. Now there's Anthony Joshua, you know, Tyson Fury. And
there was also another golden generation coming now, which is Pernell Whitaker, Azuma Nelson.
If you go to the middleweight, there was a golden generation of Sugar Ray Leonard, Thomas Hearns, Marvin Hagler.
Yeah.
So those were, because those were middle divisions.
Yeah.
But even at the time, although there was also Mike Tyson and all that, I mean, if you watch Hagler fight against Alan Minta in Wembley, you know, and that was a generation of boxers who were prepared to be called out to be the best, and they were not prepared to take the easy route. Right now, promoters and managers are looking for the easy way out, so they put people in the ring knowing that they can knock their opponents out in two rounds and then try to manage them safely. They guide them out of trouble.
Has it got something to do with the Olympics? Because a lot of the greats came from the Olympics. Even Azuma Nelson did the Commonwealth Games and won a Commonwealth title. Yeah. So the amateur division, is that where the whole world is failing? Well, the Olympics is not turning out the greatest boxers. Evander Holyfield was an Olympic gold medalist.
All the heavyweight champions, Foreman was an Olympic champion, Frazier was, Ali was, Michael Spinks was, you know, so... Sugar Ray Leonard was, you know. So the Olympics used to produce. I mean, the world has changed. Even now, I just heard that this Olympic Games in Rio, professional boxers are going to be allowed to box, which is bizarre. I find it totally bizarre how the AIBA, which is the international body that runs amateur boxing, could vote for this proposal. I don't know. The world is something that's taking
over. Everything is turning upside down in the digital age.
So now you can have boxers saying that they want to go and win the Olympic gold. Just as the tennis stars are also, because people value the gold medal, you know. But I think with boxing, they should have stuck to the amateurs. It should be a stepping stone. So that Mark Breland and the rest, who became Olympic champions, you know. And when you are moving into the professional ranks with a gold medal, it gives you a certain platform and a pedestal to jump off.
What do you expect for the funeral Friday?
Oh, I think the whole world will be mourning Ali. All of us are going to mourn him. I mean, there are no words to describe Ali, as I said. He was the paragon of virtue. He was the embodiment of a modern athlete. He He modernized sports, gave wonderful interviews, you know. He really made pre-boxing interviews a feature, you know. Mm-hmm. When people hold press conferences a day before a fight, or in the, he used to promote the fight with lovely jibes at people. And as I said, he transcended boxing. And he's, you know, his role in the civil rights movement and his level of intellect. Mm-hmm. You know, so these days, I don't want to call out names, but when you listen to some of the world champions, you want to cringe. You know, this is an intelligent person. You know, you could see that he's very well educated, you know, and knew what was around him. He was well read, you know. And then so when Ali was speaking, he was not speaking just as a boxer, but somebody who knew about world events, world affairs, and cared for people, and was prepared to move around the world, to share his fame with people all over the world. And, I think that there will never be a sportsman who makes such an impact. And I think I share with President Obama when he says that our generation should feel lucky that we lived through his time and we saw him through the spirit and were in the world when Ali was the champion of the world. Mm. The greatest is a word, as I said, has been used. It's not enough to describe him as the greatest. He's something else.
So that was Kwabede Ejapon on Muhammad Ali. Thank you, Chief. It's a pleasure.
It's a pleasure. You
can have some coffee
you
now.
You called me out of retirement.
So you're not retired anymore.
To talk about Ali, you know, he's such a great inspiration to all of us. Mm. And I'm happy to be here.
Cheers.